Well, if you have your Bibles, I would invite you to open to the book of 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy, our studies have brought us all the way to chapter 6. The Bible bus has moved, as G. Vernon McGee used to say. And we find ourselves in chapter 6 today. And as the Apostle Paul concludes this wonderful book, he does it in his usual manner, and he's going to finish strong. And I want to read that this morning. Chapter 6, the first 10 verses, and we'll get right into it. It says this: Let all who are under a yoke as bondservants regard their own masters as worthy of all honor, so that the name of God and the teaching may not be reviled. Those who have believing masters must not be disrespectful on the ground that they are brothers. Rather, they must serve all the better, since those who benefit by their good service are believers and beloved. Teach and urge these things. If anyone teaches a different doctrine and does not agree with the sound words of our Lord Jesus Christ and the teaching that accords with godliness, he is puffed up and conceit and understands nothing. He has an unhealthy craving for controversy and for quarrels about words which produce envy, dissension, slander, evil suspicions, and constant friction among people who are depraved in mind and depraved of the truth, imagining that godliness is a means of gain. But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and we cannot take anything out of this world. But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. But those who desire to be rich will fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evils. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many sorrows. This is a great passage before us today. The book of 1 Timothy really is a fabulous book. And I say that because it contains a wealth of information concerning the practical matters of the church. And we've been looking at that for the past several months, such as proper worship in a church, proper selection and qualifications of church elders, church leaders. It deals with a pastor's personal life, his duties and responsibilities as well. Also, how do we confront sin in the church? The role of women, the care of widows, how to manage the church and its leadership. In fact, Paul gave us his purpose for writing this book back in chapter 3, where he stated that you may know how one ought to behave in the household of God. And you remember we talked about that before. And this metaphor of the church body being a family is something Paul referred to often in this book. And so why was the book written? So that we as the family of God would know how to behave as God's children and as members of his universal church. How are we to behave? Timothy was pastoring a church in Ephesus. And this church was full of false teachers. And when a church has false teachers, ungodly behavior always follows. Always. That would have been a great time for an amen. But we'll just keep going. Not too late. You missed it. So, it's no surprise that the main theme of this book is godliness, which is a standard for the believer, not just for a pastor. All through the book of 1 Timothy, believers are exhorted to live godly lives. In chapter 1, you can turn back there if you want. I'm just going to read some verses or just some excerpts out of verses. But in chapter 1, verse 5, it says this: Love that issues from a pure heart and a good conscience. He's talking about, listen, be real. Be genuine. Don't be counterfeit. Be genuine. Live a godly life. Have a pure conscience, a pure heart, and love people from that. In verse 19 of chapter 1, He says, holding faith and a good conscience. Again, the same idea. In chapter 2, verse 8, he says, lifting up holy hands. Holy hands, clean hands, pure hands. Chapter 2, verse 9, it says, women should adorn themselves with modesty and self-control. Chapter 2, verse 10, the next verse, it says this, godliness with good works. That's what godliness is, good works. Chapter 3, verse 2, elders are to be above reproach. Verse 9, deacons must hold the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience as well. Doesn't mean they're perfect. It just means that when we look at them, they're above reproach. We can't point to something in their life, as I mentioned last week. Chapter 3, verse 16, this talks about the mystery of godliness in a person's life. Chapter 4, verse 7, it says, train yourself for godliness. Train yourself for godliness. We all need to be training ourselves. How do we become more godly? How do we become imitators of Christ? In the same verse, he goes on, he says, godliness is of value in every way. It's of value. It's good. In chapter 4, verse 12, he says, but set an example for the believers in, so what's the example supposed to be set in? Well, he says in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and lastly, he says in purity. Purity. He's talking about a godly lifestyle. And that's one of the main themes of this book. And then three verses later, it says that all may see your progress. So I was talking to somebody this morning, and we talked about our spiritual lives and how it is a journey that we're on. And so the idea here is that we need to work on that godliness in our lives. Now, positionally, are we pure before God? Of course. Jesus Christ made us pure. Amen? He did. But that practical righteousness, we got to work on it. We got to work to control our tongues, to control our thoughts. Maybe get rid of some old friends, whatever it takes. He says this, that all may see your progress in this area. Progress in what? Well, godliness, of course. That's the context. That's what he's talking about. In chapter 5, verse 1, it says, in all purity. Purity. Verse 4 of chapter 5, show godliness to their own household. That's the theme of this book. In verse 10, good works. Verse 21, no prejudging, no partiality. Partiality, according to James, is a sin. And then verse 22 in chapter 5, it says this, keep yourself pure. Keep yourself pure. Verse 25, good works. Chapter 6, verse 3, teaching that accords with godliness. Verse 6 of chapter 6, godliness with contentment is great gain. And then verse 11 of chapter 6, it says this, O man of God, and this will be fun to preach on next week, O man of God, pursue righteousness and godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, and gentleness. And so the standard, according to this book, the standard for the preacher, the elder, the deacon, the widow, those in authority, the young, the old, all of us, is godliness. That is the standard for the believer. And so when we come to chapter 6, our text for today, not the whole chapter, but as far as we get, it's really all about godliness. That's what it's about. And the Apostle Paul, he's going to wrap this thing up. He's wrapping up this book when we get to chapter 6, and he's just going to kind of lay it out and say, this is what's important, and this is what's in the background of his mind. It's this issue of godliness. Be godly. Be pure. Love people out of a pure heart. A good conscience. All these things. So, our text today, really, there's four things we're going to look at. And I have an outline in your bulletin. You're welcome to fill it out or not. But number one is submitting to non-Christian bosses. Number two, submitting to Christian bosses. Number three, submitting to God's word. And number four, submission through contentment. And we're going to look at our text now. So I hope you have your Bibles open. I hope you brought them. But number one, submitting to a non-Christian master. Notice verse 1. Let all who are under a yoke as bondservants regard their own masters as worthy of all honor, so that the name of God and the teaching may not be reviled. Now, this is a great test for godliness. You know, a lot of us have different ideas about what godliness is. And Paul here, he's laying it out. And notice the picture he paints for us in verse 1. He says, as bondservants. A bondservant in the Greek, it's a slave. That's what it is. He says, listen, you're a slave, a bondservant. And he wanted the people to understand. And so he uses this social component of the first century, and that was slavery. Historians tell us that in the Roman Empire, at least half the population were slaves. Half. One half. And there was approximately, if you can wrap your mind around this, there were approximately 50 to 60 million slaves in the Roman Empire in the first century. That's a lot of slaves. And many were prisoners of war. They could be purchased. They could be sold. Oftentimes, they sold themselves into slavery because they didn't felt like they had no other way to go and they could be taken care of. Others were sold to pay a debt, and others were still born into slavery. But something interesting happened here. The gospel message of forgiveness and freedom in Christ appealed to these slaves, and many of them became believers. It's also important to say that Paul here was not placing a stamp of approval on slavery. That's not the point here. He was just making a point of what godliness looked like. And the situation of the day, the slavery of the day, he's not talking from the position of the slave owner. He's talking about to the slaves themselves who became a believer. And he's making a point, even to us today. Even the way he starts the chapter out tells us that he didn't approve of slavery. Notice verse 1 again. Let all who are under a what? A yoke as bondservants. Well, the term yoke was a term used for a beast of burden. Farmers would lay a wooden beam across the shoulders of an ox and cinch it tight, and they would harness it to a plow or whatever they were going to do with that animal. And so slaves really were considered no better than animals at the time. But don't miss the point of this verse. Again, true godliness would be a slave who was treated as an animal, giving honor to their ungodly owners. Wow. Now that's godliness. Right there. It doesn't matter the situation I'm in. God wants me to rise above it and to honor that unbelieving master. And this is a standard for the believers. We are always to do the right thing in our life, no matter what. In this case, it was a Christian slave honoring their ungodly owner. I love the book of Jude. Don't turn there. But even though the book is only one chapter long, it's a powerful book. Believers are told to persevere in the midst of a crooked and corrupt society in a world. And he talks about those who do deeds of ungodliness. And he specifies, he names some of these sins: grumblers, malcontents, those following their own sinful desires, scoffers following their own ungodly passions, worldly people, void of the Spirit. And then he says two of the most powerful words in Scripture. And that is, he talks about them, and then he says this: but you. But you. The world can act ungodly. They can complain. They can grumble. They can follow and chase after sin. But Jude makes a sharp contrast. But you. But you. Believer, it must be different for you. It's got to be different. We have an ungodly, dark world out there looking at us. and we stand up for Jesus Christ. Christian slave, honor your master as our text says, worthy of all honor. Were they worthy of all honor? No. Didn't matter. He was speaking to that slave. He was speaking to that servant. Worthy of all honor. And wow, the ungodly slave sure isn't going to do it. But you, be different. Be godly. Why? Notice your text. Notice the verse, 1b. Notice what he tells us, why that Christian slave should honor his ungodly master. Why? 1b. So that, you should underline this, so that the name of God and the teaching may not be blasphemed. Now that's pretty powerful. Pretty powerful. And it's practical too. Listen, my life is to bring glory to God. That's it. It's to bring glory to God. I'm coaching varsity baseball at DCA this year, Desert Christian Academy, and our team verse that I picked out for this year is 1 Corinthians 10:31. It says this, so whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. And I talk to these guys and I tell them, every practice, listen, where does baseball fit into this? Whatever you do, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, what are we to do? We're to do it to the glory of God. Examples, our testimony. Why do we play baseball? We play baseball for the glory of God, to point people to Christ. They see something different about us. When the umpire screws up a call, we don't kick dirt on them. I may let them know in love. In fact, our 2 games ago, our umpire, I've been gone for a while. I came back and coaching again. But I went to meet the umpire, and I'm looking at him, and I'm going, wow, something about you looks familiar. And he goes, hi, my name is Cindy. And I'm going, Cindy, you look like Curtis to me. I remember Curtis. Is that you? And he's going, yeah, Doc, it's me. I had a sex change and coaching baseball, but I'm still a good ump, you know. And lost, empty people all around us. And what do they need? They need a Christian to be an example in front of them, pointing them to God. Wow. Godliness is not wearing a shirt and tie. It's not bad. Just reading a King James Bible, coming to church, serving in the church. Godliness is to honor an evil, godless reprobate when no other slave in the empire will. That's the point of that verse. Tough message. Tough message. Why? Because he wants to bring glory to his real master, not the ungodly master, his real master. Let's keep moving. The second example he gives us of godliness is, number two, is submitting to a believing masters. And notice verse number two, it says, those who have believing masters must not be disrespectful on the ground that they are brothers. Rather, they must serve all the better, since those who benefit by their good service are believers and beloved. You love them. Work hard. That's the point. The temptation here is for those with Christian masters, they were not to expect to be set free. That's not the point here. The point is, honor that master. Work harder than anybody else. And again, this passage is not dealing with the morality of the of slavery, and it's not about the master's perspective. It's all about the slave's perception. It's all about him. It's about the slave and his perspective. So often we justify our actions, and I'm guilty of it too. We justify our actions because of someone else instead of doing what the Lord Jesus says is true religion, what is godliness and what it looks like. I do it. And I'm sure you do it too. We all do it. The point here, the godly slave wasn't to expect special treatment. He wasn't to slack off, but rather he was to, as our text says, he was to serve all the better. Work harder than everyone else. Why? Because you bring glory to God. Encourage that Christian owner, that authority. Encourage him. Work hard to keep their testimony as a Christian. The latter part of verse number 2, it's easier to understand from the Greek, and it reads this, "But all the more let them serve because they are believers and they're loved, the ones from their good service receiving help." Yes, you are brothers, but work harder than everybody else. Be an example. You want to be godly? Don't tell us how godly you are. Show us good works. Be that godly employee. Why? Because they take care of you. They take care of you and your family. Number 3, verses 3 to 5 talks about submitting to the word of God. And this is, I get it. This is tough. This is a hard message here, but he wants to make the point. What does godliness look like? Submitting to the word of God, starting in verse 3. "If anyone teaches a different doctrine and does not agree with the sound words of our Lord Jesus Christ and the teaching that accords with," what? Godliness. It's got to jive. It's got to be there. "He is puffed up with conceit and understands nothing. He has an unhealthy craving for controversy and for quarrels about words, which produce envy, dissension, slander, evil suspicions, and constant friction among people who are depraved in mind and depraved of the truth, imagining that godliness is a means of gain." He's making this contrast here. It just jumps out at us as we read this. Heteros didasko, and it means to teach a different doctrine, in verses sound doctrine, which you talked about earlier in the book. Sound doctrine, teach it, be there, preach it. And he's saying, listen, there's those who do the other doctrine, a different heteros doctrine. Don't do it. And he's already dealt with this in chapter 4. The lives of false teachers will be characterized by sin. Notice the sins. Verse 4, it says this, puffed up, conceited. I like that word conceited. It means smoke. But the verb form used here means puff up like a cloud of smoke. Doesn't that describe some folks, some false teachers that maybe you've heard? False teachers speak arrogantly, words of vanity, and also in verse 4b, it says this, they understand nothing. Turn your TV on sometime. Watch some of these guys. False teachers, they understand nothing. All they want, give me your money, and I'm going to get in my, I don't even know what they cost, $10 million jet and fly around. They understand nothing. No truth, just smoke, controversy, quarrels about words. Means that they battle over words like that matters. Election, don't argue, just come ask me and I'll tell you what it means, all right? These are pseudo-intellectual arguments instead of submission to God's word. That's the point he's making here, which produces godliness. False teachers, according to verse 5, only produces constant friction among these people who are depraved of the truth. And so, here's the point he's making. All of the Bible, the total Bible, instructs a person and leads them to a godly life. It does. So what do we got to do? We got to open it and read it. Study it. In the morning, get out of bed, get your cup of coffee, sit on the couch, lay in bed, whatever it is. God, speak to me. Speak to me. I need to understand. Love not the world or the things that are in the world. Okay, that's enough for today. I got to think about that. That's good. Speak to me, Lord. Notice verse 5b, these false teachers, they make it about money. It says, imagining that godliness is a means of gain. This isn't about money. This is about Bruce from Yellow Mart. This is about the two girls that are abused by their father. This is about all of us getting pointed to Christ by James and Melissa and the praise team every Sunday morning. Serious, serious stuff. For some, it is about money. Godliness shows up in a believer's life when they submit to the authority of God's word. And that's the point he's trying to make here. Don't listen to me. Listen to the word of God. And everything I say, you should check it against God's word and see if I'm being a false teacher or if I'm offline, if I'm going down somewhere I shouldn't be going. Check everything I say. My preaching must steer you to godly living. That's what he's saying here. And because the Bible is about godliness, the two, my preaching and the Bible, the word of God, they've got to line up. They have to. Must. And they better line up. Or the elders are going to tar and feather me and send me to Brawley or somewhere. Number four, submitting to contentment. I want to park here just for a few moments. This is, sorry about that Brawley note there. Joy lived in Brawley for many, many years. I have a wedding down there this next weekend, so I'll be down there. Submitting to contentment. And you say, well, you have to submit to contentment? Yeah, you do. We're going to read that in a moment here, but notice verses 6 through 10. It says this, but godliness with contentment is great gain. Why? For we brought nothing into this world, and we cannot take anything out of this world. But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evils. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith. Now, before you call me a heretic or say, hey, does that mean we can lose our salvation, Pastor? That's not what he's talking about here. He's talking about they've left the tenets, the truth of the faith, the true faith. They've just gone sideways. God will deal with them. Of course he will. And it says they pierced themselves with many sorrows. And that's exactly what that does. Let me sum this up. Be content with what God has given you. Be content. We were born naked and empty-handed. We came into this world. And guess what? We take nothing with us when we leave, except only the rewards we've stored up in heaven. We're going to talk about that in a moment. But notice the phrase in verse 6, but godliness with contentment. And these are two different things, this godliness and contentment. And they're saying when you put them together, there's some great gain here, right? Godliness is love from a pure heart, a clean conscience, keeping a life of faith, living in the realm of faith, being able to lift up holy hands, being above reproach. It has to do with our speech, our conduct, our love. It shows up when we do love others. It's revealed in our good works. Now that's godliness. But notice again what he says in the verse. Godliness with meta contentment. Meta means along with, put together, the two put together, they equal something. What is it that they equal? Great gain. Great gain. Great gain means an inner sufficiency that keeps us at peace in spite of outward circumstances. It doesn't matter what circumstance I'm in. It doesn't matter if I'm a slave. Am I for slavery? Slavery was horrible. Of course. That's not his point. The point is, whatever situation you find yourself in today, be content. We can be content. There's great gain being godly, and you mix it with contentment, and it doesn't matter what circumstance I'm in. I'm able to rise above it as a believer and say, it's got to be different for me because I'm a child of the King of Kings. It will be different. And verse number 7 sums this up. Notice, he says this again, we brought nothing into this world and we cannot take anything out of this world. You can't. You got a nice watch? Great. I can't take it with me. It stays. The house, the car, it doesn't matter. The gold, the silver, the bank account, whatever it is you have, it all stays behind. I've done countless funerals, and I'll tell you this. Every person who passed away, there's something common. They left everything behind, every one of them. There was no hearse behind. There was no U-Haul behind the hearse. There wasn't. They left it all behind. I love history. By the age of 29, historians tell us that Alexander the Great, he conquered the whole known world. 29. And he got back to his palace, and there was nobody else to conquer. And so what did he do? Well, he started drinking, and he drank himself to death. Before his death, he commanded his generals, he says, my life's a ruin. He goes, but I don't want my men to follow me. He loved his men. They conquered the whole world. Of course he loved his men. He said this, in my coffin, I want you to cut two holes in the sides, and I want you to stick my arms out, and I want my hands to be open, so that when you parade me down the middle of the street in my carriage, I want my armies, my men, to know that I left it all behind. I left it all behind. I conquered the world, but it all got left behind. And so what do we need as believers? How does this speak to us, you and I? Notice verse 8. But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. That's all I need. Food and clothing. Contentment is based on our needs, not our wants. I would ask you this morning, do you have food in your cupboard? You have clothes covering your body? Then do what Paul did. He said this in Philippians. Don't turn there. He said this, for I have learned, it didn't come natural. He had to learn it. For I have learned in whatever situation I am in to be what? Content. I learned it. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. Well, what's the secret, Paul? What is it? Well, I think it's verse 13, the famous verse in Philippians. And this is the context of it. I can do what? All things through Christ, through him who strengthens me. That's the context of that verse. Doesn't matter. And Paul goes on in our text to tell his readers, he goes, it's not about money. It's not about being rich. And the problem with these false teachers had is they stated, like in verse 9, he says this, those who desire to be rich, they fall into a temptation, into a snare, or a trap from the enemy, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. Verse 10, for the love of money. It's not money. That's not the problem. It's the love. It's that heart. It's that mind issue. I got to get more, more, more. I got to work more overtime. Sundays, I got to do whatever it takes to get more money. It says that they have wandered away from the faith. They went sideways. They got away from the truth of Scripture. They got away. And in turn, it says that they have pierced themselves with many sorrows. You want sorrows? Do what he says there. And make your life where you just want to be miserable and full of sorrows. Chase money and riches. And that'll happen. Do you see the contrast he's making here in this passage? It's easy to see. At least for me it is. And good, sound preaching, doctrine produces godliness with contentment. That's the key. Submit to God and what He has provided for you. Don't listen to the prosperity preachers. They're false teachers. That's it. And they were a problem in the first century, and they're a problem still today. Satan's not really creative in his attacks. He does the same things over and over again. You think we would learn? Let me give you some application. We're doing good on time. Number one, there is always a higher standard for the believer. Always. Always. Submit to the authority of God, whoever that is, who He's placed you under. Honor that boss of yours. Thank him or her for providing that job for you. And then work harder than anyone else with a good attitude. What a concept. Submit yourself to the authority and the truth of God's word, the Bible. Don't buy the lies of the evil one. What he is selling comes with a high price tag. Emptiness, discontentment, sorrows, just to name a few. The world chases so many empty dreams, don't they? They do, but not so for us. We're different. But you, believer, we have chosen our path. The second application I see here as I read this passage is this. Make it your life's goal to seek godliness, not riches. If God has blessed you financially, He's blessed me financially. Praise God. Amen. I'm into it. It's good. Use it for Him. Use it for His glory. Spook, I know you do. Of course you do. I've seen it. What did Jesus say? He said this, lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. And then he says this brilliant statement, for where your treasure is, there will your what? Heart be also. Where's your heart? Is it, I want to be godly? That's what I want. I want to know Christ. I want to reach out to the lost. I want God to send me to the unsaved people when I'm driving to a soccer game or you too. That's what I want. And if God has blessed you financially, there's nothing wrong with that. Great. I hope all of you get blessed. You can tithe more. Just a side note, I have no idea if you give a dollar or give $1 million every year. I don't count that. I don't even get a list. I don't want to know. None of my business. You know that. But if God has blessed you, thank Him and use your resources for His glory and His kingdom. I love what Peter wrote about godliness. Listen to this. He said, His divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Isn't that good? And so what is he saying? He's saying, listen, it's a reachable goal. You can be godly. It's available through Christ. Now, we must die to ourselves and he lives through us. That's that secret. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can't do it on my own. And thirdly, I would say this as far as application. Learn to be content. Learn to be content. And I'll tell you this, practical, this is not from the Word of God. This is doc speaking. If you can't be content living in a $200 a month apartment, you will not be content living in a mansion in Beverly Hills. That's how it works. Be content, whatever God, whatever situation, whatever place He has you in. Learn to be content. Learn it. Paul says, I've learned. It takes works. I have to deny myself, but it always, always requires thankfulness. Thank you, God, for everything you've given me. I'm so blessed. Look at me. I'm 3 pounds overweight. Don't laugh at that. maybe four or five. I'll give you that.
Amen.
Thank you. Oh, boy. It's a tough crowd. It always requires thankfulness. If we as believers, we want that great gain in our lives, it only comes through godliness with contentment. And we got to learn how to be content. I got to be content, Lord. Thank you for all you've given me, you've done in my life. It means nothing. It came and it could go away tomorrow, and it's not going to change how I serve you, how I love you, and it's not going to change my relationship with you. It's all yours. Lastly, one more thing. I threw this in. Who's your master? Who's your master, right? I think as we look at this whole passage here, who's your master? Who do you belong to? Who do you serve? Who do you want to please? In the Apostle Paul, he's wrapping up this letter with this high standard of godliness, which most churches don't want to talk about, or and they don't and won't talk about. And today, we want to encourage you to go live for your master. Go live for your master. No matter what situation, no matter what your health is, it doesn't matter. Absent from the body, present with who? The Lord. It's a win-win. Love him through your obedience to him. And I invite you to come back next week to the conclusion of 1 Timothy, or next couple weeks. I'm not sure how far we're going to get. It's a great, great book. And this is the ultimate source of truth for my life and for your life. And who are we? We are his children who are just trying to figure it out. And we're on this journey together, and we want to bring honor and glory to our master. That's who we are. Father, we thank you for your word and how practical it is and how it speaks to us so powerfully. And Lord, I just pray that we would just honor those, the authority that's over us. And even when we don't want to, or it just seems so wrong, for us it's different. And you've told us to what the standard is for us, but you, and help us, each one of us that are here that know you as their personal Savior, Lord, that we would submit to you, your word, and your authority in our lives, and that we would have true godliness and our works would be pleasing to you in this dark, ugly world that's outside here, that they would look at us and say, there's something different about those people. There's something different. Tell me, what makes your life different? Father, we love you. We are your church, and we are striving to be obedient to you through godly lives. We thank you and praise you. In your son's name we pray. Amen.